My name is Peter Scheer. I'm the seismology section president, and this is Karen Fisher, the president-elect, and we'd like to welcome you to one of the highlights of the fall meeting for the seismology section, the Gutenberg Lecture, and the presentation of the Aki Award. But first, I'd like to remind you that we're having a joint seismology tectonophysics reception tonight. It's over in the Marriott Golden Gate Salon A. And each year we spend some of our precious section funds on two things mainly. One, on student travel grants to this meeting, and the other is to provide beer and wine at the reception. So I hope you'll come tonight to take advantage of the free booze that we'll have. In addition, we're going to be informally honoring our newly elected AGU fellows. Okay, well, it's my pleasure tonight to begin by presenting the winner of the 2011 Keaki Young Scientist Award. This AGU award was established by our section in 2008. It's given every year to an outstanding young seismologist who is within 3 years of receiving her or his PhD. This year's winner is Andreas Fichtner. Andreas got his bachelor's degree from the University of Mining Technology in Germany, then was a Fulbright student at the University of Washington for a year, before going to graduate school at the Maximilian University in Munich, where he got his PhD in 2009. During his studies, he also spent time at IPG in Paris and at ANU in Australia. He's currently a postdoc at Utrecht. Andreas has worked on a range of topics, including adjoint inversion methods, numerical methods, full waveform inversion. He's applied all of these techniques in a number of regional tomography problems. His PhD thesis was published as a book by Springer last year. He already has a substantial body of work, and he's on track to have a brilliant career. So please join me in congratulating Andreas Fichtner, winner of the 2011 Aki Award. And I have a certificate that we will give.
Congratulations. Good job.
Now we turn to the main event today, the presentation of the Gutenberg Lecture. This year's lecture will be given by Thorne Lay of the University of California, Santa Cruz. It's hard to give a short introduction to Thorne's many accomplishments, but I'll try. He grew up in El Paso, Texas, went to the University of Rochester, then got his PhD from Caltech in 1983. He was on the faculty of Michigan for about 10 years before moving to Santa Cruz in 1994, where he's been ever since. Thorne achieved fame early on as a grad student by discovering a shear velocity discontinuity in the lowermost mantle in the D double prime region. And he's best known for his continuing research on the core mantle boundary region and also for studies of very large earthquake ruptures. But he's also worked on a variety of other problems, including many results on issues related to monitoring nuclear explosions. He co-authored a classic textbook in seismology and has won numerous awards, including AGU's McIlwainy Medal. And he'll be talking tonight about great earthquake ruptures in the age of seismogeodesy. So please join me in welcoming Thorne Lay.
All right, thanks. Well, thank everybody for coming. This lecture is just a celebration of some of the accomplishments in which I've played a relatively small part, but I think collectively we've made great progress in advancing our ability to understand the most dramatic and hugest of earthquakes. So this is sort of a celebration of great earthquakes as much as any celebration of my minor contributions there. So I'm going to talk about some of the recent spate of activity that is prompting, I guess, the reason that we would focus on great earthquakes in this particular overall talk. This map indicates pretty much why we're here. There's been a spate of large earthquakes in the last 7 years that it's not unprecedented, but it's kept us very busy. There have been great earthquakes occurring in all of these regions indicated here. We can add up about 13 magnitude 8 or larger events in the last 7 year period going back to December 2004 when we had events down here in Macquarie, followed soon after by event in Sumatra. And the reason that this is a particularly interesting interval is that the rate at which events are happening at about close to two events per year, this is kind of the average to today, is about 2.5 times the long-term average that we enjoyed, if you want to use that word, over the last century. So it is a dramatic interval of great earthquake occurrence, and this has been, you know, the subject of much discussion as to what's causing this behavior. Is it natural fluctuations of the occurrence of earthquakes or whatever? I'm not going to try to address that problem, but this is the timeline from the seismological kind of dawn of instrumentation around 1900 to present, showing the great earthquakes that have happened. And we see that this recent large number or concentration of particularly large earthquakes is somewhat comparable to what was experienced in the 1950s and 60s. And when you look at this timeline and think about the reason that we're having the Gutenberg celebration, it's indicated here. Bino was a student of Wiechert, and he got his PhD back in 1911. He came to the U.S. He joined Caltech faculty as the director of the first seismolab, the first director, when it moved from Carnegie. So that was 1930. And then he served as director up until 1957 when Frank Press took over. And during that time, he had tremendous collaborations with Charles Richter. They studied great earthquakes and earthquakes all over the world, wrote, you know, great compendiums of the events that were known and documented historically. He studied every depth range within the Earth, from the inner core through the low velocity zone and the manto. He's a major player and created the seismolab as a force in global seismology. And it was when I first got to Caltech myself in 1978, I got the honor of an extra scholarship that was called the Bino Gutenberg Scholarship, and I was interested. So I went into the archive of reprints and studied many of the papers from Bino Gutenberg and developed a tremendous respect for the breadth of his accomplishments and his signature impact on the Caltech Seismolab. And it persists to today. When you go back and read it, his papers are very impressive and creative and diverse. So he had a lot of impact. And there was a couple of papers. I was particularly interested in his discussions of seismicity around the world and his discussions of the core mantle boundary, both of which influenced the directions that I pursued as a graduate student and subsequently. When I got to Caltech right here in 1978, began working with Hiro Kanemori on some earlier big earthquakes, and we were forced to use old WWSSN data. I spent months digitizing records of surface waves recorded from the analog recordings. And while we were able to analyze events, we were mainly looking back over the prior couple of decades where the WWSSN had been recording signals and we could quantify earthquakes. And I thought, well, great earthquakes are very interesting and exciting, and they just stopped. They ended. I started working on the core mantle boundary following Gutenberg into the deep interior because the big earthquakes weren't happening. And at the time, the WWSSN was going down. We weren't going to record them if they did occur. And fortunately, the community undertook efforts to build up instrumentation in preparation, anticipating the return of the occurrence of global great earthquakes around the world. So we went from kind of the dark days of no big earthquakes to the good times today. In terms of kind of preparing ourselves for analyzing these earthquakes. And of course, great earthquakes, I don't mean to make light of them. They're devastating and can be horrible events. But in terms of seismological understanding, being able to capture, record, and analyze these events has greatly advanced our understanding just in the past 7 or 8 years. As a student, we were exploring ideas motivated by early studies of big earthquakes, people like Larry Ruff and myself working with Hiro Kanemori, who had the great vision of kind of trying to relate the occurrence of big earthquakes to the environments they were occurring, the diversity of environments, trying to understand why they happened and what their attributes were that distinguished end member behaviors, failure in places like Chile versus Marianas or Izu-Bonin regions that didn't seem to have big earthquakes. And we had some basic notions that developed into the kind of asperity model, idea of heterogeneity of the strength or frictional properties of fault. And we'll see at the end that those are still with us today. Now, during these dark ages, when there weren't really any big earthquakes to divert us, tremendous achievements in both the theory for simulating seismic wave propagation in the Earth and for dealing with the characterization of big earthquakes, if and when they would come, was developed. So there was great advances. This is my favorite list of papers that, you know, I invoke students should read because they represent real advances in our understanding of making synthetic seismograms and inverting them. You'll see I get all the way down this list. They're all Caltech people. I'm sorry for that, but this is, after all, the Beano Gutenberg celebration. So largely Caltech, down to the wonderful paper by Miyazaki, where they began to do complete Green's function inversion of high-rate GPS. And this is an area that now Caltech is pursuing, but they laid the foundations for our ability to analyze the earthquakes when they would come. And indeed, they did come. Between 1900 and 2011, this is how the cumulative seismic moment release around the world has varied. And if you look at the recent interval, you'll see it's actually just been popping off so regularly that the overall slope is steeper than you might encounter at any time except for this 1950s and 1960s interval where we had a lot of great earthquakes. So it's a great time to have big earthquakes if we can record them and analyze them with all the new tools. And fortunately, beginning in the 1980s, we began to build instrumentation that could record, capture the complete ground motions, either for seismic recordings or for geodetic recordings. We developed techniques for using GPS and other methods to get very comprehensive geodetic constraints on great earthquakes. And all those methods kind of matured, became widely implemented, large data collection efforts were undertaken, and then the Earth obliged us with a lot of big earthquakes that we could study. The big earthquake studies have kept me very fascinated. I've gone back to work on events, large earthquakes, pretty much after 2000 because they were suddenly happening and we had tremendous data. And as we analyzed the events, we'd find that every event had an interesting story. That's sort of typical of studies of earthquakes. They're all complex events, but in particular, we had developed framework notions of how the Earth should work and how big earthquakes should occur based on simple asperity models or tectonic stress transfer models. And almost all those ideas have been tested, if not refuted, by the actual occurrence of great earthquakes. So we're learning a lot about what we had as misunderstandings or what we needed to gain further insight into from the analysis of the big earthquakes. And we have the data to do it, both seismic and geodetic data in large quantities that allow us to penetrate into the detailed rupture processes of events with much more detail than we'd ever been able to do, particularly with old WSSN data or even worse when Gutenberg would have been working when they had very few poorly calibrated global instruments to analyze earthquakes with, and no geodetic constraints other than the leveling lines. This is a list. I won't go through all these, but it's basically these are studies I've participated in with colleagues over the last 10 years, and all the work here is going to be presented with a lot of co-authors. I'm not going to belabor them all. So my role in this is as partner and an enthusiast for understanding these earthquakes. A lot of this work has been conducted with Chuck Amon of Penn State and Hiro Kanemori of Caltech, as we've gotten together to exploit the data sets and look at this, but we've had many other collaborators. And if you look at the number of interesting and surprising attributes of events, it's one for every earthquake that's happened. They've all had surprises, from something like Sumatra, which managed to rupture not just a more or less expectable offshore zone off of Banda Aceh, but then proceeded to run 1,000 kilometers to the north along an island arc in which the plate motion is almost parallel to the strike of the arc, and yet it was thrusting. It was quite a remarkable event, and it really challenged demonstrated the limitations of the capabilities that we had developed throughout the prior 25 years of this, this sort of dark time, because those techniques had been applied largely in the context of magnitude 6, magnitude 7 earthquakes, and we had not seen a magnitude 9 and did not realize that we were going to have a lot of limitations of the algorithms and the approaches that we were using when we had to suddenly analyze an event that had ruptured 1,300 kilometers of fault and had a duration of over 450 seconds. Almost everybody's algorithms failed, and this was a major transition point for us that led everybody to ramp up their capabilities, and that was good preparation for all the subsequent events. We've been able to handle them quite well collectively in the community. You all have. Looking back at Sumatra, it's been extraordinary because you have this huge rupture in 2004 that, as I said, this portion of it, perhaps not too surprising, the fact that it ruptured all the way to the north and re-ruptured regions that had failed before in smaller events, kind of opened our eyes to the potential for great earthquakes to defy simple segmentation ideas and even to defy plate tectonic scenarios of where convergence and slip partitioning would be occurring. And it was quite a transitional event in our understanding. Of course, it produced a large sequence of activity in 2005, large events in 2007 that have further ruptured along the Sumatran arc. And there is this, I think, hot spot in between which has remained unruptured, which would be my candidate for where you might have a devastating future earthquake, which is the northern part of the 1797 rupture zone. This is an area that Carrie C. and others are also looking at very closely and instrumenting to anticipate what might happen in that region. Now, the tools that had developed from the kind of theory and observational capabilities led to many studies that, by and large, there are differences amongst the studies. And people tend to emphasize differences, but I tend to emphasize how much more we're able to quantify than in the past, even if there are some discrepancies. And this is just a summary of many of Jarl's contributions to our understanding of the slip distribution of this earthquake, now using sophisticated inversions of seismic waves, inversions of GPS, co-seismic measurements from largely campaign data was available for these events, also using tsunami observations to make records. And this suite of models is representative of kind of the early stages where there were still methods development. We were adjusting our algorithms to accommodate the great time duration of this event, the great magnitude of the displacements and characterization of the fault length that had to be adjusted for 2004. So that happened pretty quickly, and the community responded within a couple of months. So on the day of the earthquake, almost everybody's algorithms failed. I think maybe Chuck Amon's worked the best. We were able to get the full source time function that day, but it took many groups a long time to figure out that there was something happening after 3 minutes, simply because their algorithms couldn't accommodate the complex Green's functions that were needed to describe the full range of duration for this event. The agreement is what I want to emphasize, and this compares the geodetic model and seismic model of slip along the fault from some of the studies, and it's quite impressive. I mean, it's really remarkable that we could get this level of agreement in the early phases of applying these methods and analysis procedures for this unprecedented data set for such a mammoth earthquake. And this is largely work that it was a community effort to try to get together all the techniques and try and get the best representation of this earthquake. The geodetic data was analyzed. It took almost a year to get the really good models out, but it came in with quite good agreement. And I've been very impressed with that kind of convergence of seismic and geodetic characterizations, separate characterizations. And it has led to efforts for smaller events before this and for subsequent large events to actually meld together the seismic and geodetic observations and do seismogeodesy. So I put that word into the title, not to be cute, but because that's really where we're at in that both geodetic and seismic recordings of ground motion can be interpreted jointly and lead to the best overall characterization of ruptures though it's still somewhat in its infancy in that we're improving our capabilities and our models for the Greens functions. In parallel with this, 2004 was the first event to really demonstrate that by having large networks of teleseismic observations, you could back project high frequencies and begin to image energy that was always neglected in these inversions for large slip distributions on earthquakes. This would be a model based on long period energy inverting for slip distribution and tsunami excitation. Over here, this has GPS, I think, as well. Over here on the right is an image form from using network recordings, large numbers of short periods, and back projecting them. Part of the signal that we've always ignored prior to this, but it was introduced by Miyake Ishii, was the co-author lead author with several others that developed techniques like this, and Kruger and Ornberger, to take array data, image where on the fault did high frequency energy coherent sources or subsources, where did they emit energy and at what time, and they kind of track along here. You can see this distribution of sources. This is from Kruger and Ornberger, I believe, and the distribution is somewhat similar to but offset from the slip distribution, and we'll see that that's a common attribute of the large earthquakes. But it was the first time that we had capabilities such as this, because we had acquired the large network data and we developed new techniques. This is primarily Miyake led the way in her group, but a lot of others have followed on. This is an example of the work I've done with Keith Cooper. And what we have found is very similar kind of concentration of high frequency radiation that you see from different networks. This is through the FNET in Japan. This is through European station. You get similar images, and they are systematically shifted in position from where the large slip events are as determined by seismic and geodetic inversions. And this is an interesting attribute. Hasn't been emphasized for this event. People have just kind of noted the along strike similarities, but without really paying that much attention to the down dip. If we summarize here where I think the best representations of long period slip are, where large co-seismic slips are from long period seismic waves and geodetic, that would be in the yellow areas, whereas the high frequency radiation seems to be coming from down dip at depths of 35 to 50 kilometers on the fault, whereas a lot of the slip is up in the range from 15 to 35 kilometers. So that's an interesting attribute, and we'll come back to that because we see it again and again. Another surprising event was the observation of a large tsunami earthquake that occurred up dip of prior big thrust events in 2007. There are a couple of the events along the central portion of Sumatra. Here we have a 7.8 earthquake occurring in the region that shouldn't have earthquakes at all. It's a very shallow region. The only types of events that we tend to see in this very shallow, right up to the trench area, are characterized as having very low rupture velocities. They can have large displacements, though, and produce large tsunamis as a consequence. So Hiro had identified such events as tsunami earthquakes because there's strong tsunami excitation and typically very low MB or MS measurements for the events due to rupturing slowly. And we found that in this case, we have portions of the arc that it had just recently, a couple of years earlier, large interplate thrusting events. And we sort of would anticipate that the hazard had been reduced and focus on the unruptured along arc regions. And then we find that there could be kind of squeezed into the shallowest region, very tsunami-genic, very dangerous additional earthquakes. And these events seem to be infrequent, but that may simply be that they have long recurrence intervals between them. And we haven't observed that many. The list of them is growing, so that now tsunami earthquakes could be deemed to be potential along many regions that we had thought would not necessarily have seismogenic capability, that you would be in the weak sediment part of the accretionary prism and you would be unable to build up large strains. Mentawai also illustrates the value of campaign data that had been collected and high-rate GPS data collected in arcs that we knew were had some seismic potential. And so some of the efforts from the Caltech Tectonics Observatory and Kerry C's group have put in GPS along the Mentawai Islands, exploiting the offshore presence of the islands to measure strain accumulation in this case. And though they did this after the 2007 events, they could highlight what areas had been locked, identified in red here as regions that were building up strain and potentially had a slip deficit that could fail in a large earthquake. And it corresponds pretty well to the regions that actually ruptured. And it's difficult to see all the way to the trench with the island-based or onshore on land observations, but it was recognized that there was some potential in this region off of Pagai Island, if I can point to it right. Now, those type of high-rate GPS data are pretty spectacular. If you can accumulate such data, not only can you address the long-term accumulation of deformation and infer the strain that leads us to ideas of locking of the fault or some sort of deficit of the slip relative to the tectonic motions, that gives you a basis for identifying what areas are likely to have future events. But by continuously operating the GPS through the earthquake, you also get wonderful records like these from Carrie C's data of the arrival of seismic vibrations. This is Rayleigh wave oscillation, and you can see the step is the static motion. So you can get complete ground recordings that contain both seismic and geodetic or static type of deformation histories. And all of this information is now becoming available for us to analyze. And whereas the typical tendency had been to kind of separate the seismic from the geodetic, there's no real reason to do so with these types of signals. And then that ushers in the age of seismogeodesy that we are entering into. Now, these signals are similar. The kind of strong motion recordings have provided a lot of the dynamic recordings of large earthquakes in close, so we haven't had that many records. You can reconstruct a lot of attributes of this energy from strong motion recordings, but the double integration problem is often less stable than you can attain for getting the long periods from the GPS. Conversely, these don't have as high a frequency. It's difficult to get solutions and avoid all the multipathing problems to get the highest frequencies out of these signals. So there's still a great complementary asset of having strong motion recordings and continuous GPS recordings and seismic broadband recordings. This is just to illustrate that those data also can be inverted. This is inverting just the static components and finding a slip model that's comparable to the seismic slip models that we have. We're actually now simultaneously inverting both the seismic and these high-rate GPS data to try and improve the model. So I won't show any of those results here. Looking at a few of the other great earthquake examples that have surprised us, here's a tremendous doublet in 2006-2007, still kind of the best defined doublet interaction for great earthquakes that we've seen. We've seen a long strike extension of the Sumatra 2004 and 2005 events, but this is a different type of doublet in that you had a large underthrusting event. This is the Central Kurils, where the Pacific Plate is going under the Kuril Islands here. And this is about an 8.4 underthrusting event. It's in a surprising location where we had not had prior great earthquake recorded. It's an area where the arc is disrupted. It actually has a basin in the upper plate and the forearc that's unlike anywhere else along the Kurils. There was great uncertainty in whether this was seismically coupled well enough to have a great earthquake. Well, it did, but it was concentrated very close to the trench with large slip near the trench. And this event was particularly intriguing because it activated at the same time as the main thrusting event, activated outer rise extensional faulting, which is typically observed following large interplate thrusting events. And that's typically relatively small magnitude, normal faulting at shallow depth in the outer rise or in the trench slope. But in this case, that occurred, the aftershock activity died down, but then after 60 days, you suddenly broke this region with a magnitude 8 normal faulting event. So you went from thrust faulting to extensional faulting, a pair of magnitude 8 size great earthquakes in close proximity, clearly a stress transfer and interaction that says that there is kind of a need to really understand why the delay is occurring and what are the nature of the stress interactions. This shows the seismicity history as a function of time going from left to right. Here's going to be the activity along the megathrust, and this will be the activity in the outer rise. You see that you had some foreshock activity along the megathrust. You have the large underthrusting event, immediately activated outer rise activity. That goes through an aftershock decay, and then boom, you get a magnitude 8 rupture that probably goes through the upper 30 kilometers of the oceanic lithosphere. And this kind of remarkable sequence ends up with this complementary pattern of thrust events and normal faulting events. It's still not fully quantified, there wasn't much geodetic information. There was some campaign data that had been collected, and it provides a bit of additional information that this region had been coupled, but there wasn't enough data. We need to get more high-rate GPS along all these major subduction zones where that can happen. This is just a cross-section to indicate the thrusting followed by the normal faulting. And then in 2009, there was a large compressional event at greater depth. Might anticipate that this is this extension, this compression is some stress regime associated with bending plausibly, or it could be some sort of stress transfer within the elastic part of the lithosphere, some interaction of this normal faulting inducing this thrust faulting. Hasn't been fully worked out, but it's the type of sequence that we can document and quantify exceedingly well now with the data that are available. That event kind of re-intrigued me about the interaction between the interplate thrusting and outer rise. And then a very surprising event occurred in 2009. This is the Samoa doublet. I put that in quotes because even today in the catalogs, it's listed as a single event. And it was a complicated earthquake with outer rise normal faulting seaward of, this is the northern part of the Tonga subduction zone where it curves around. The Pacific plate is going under the Lau Basin here along the northern part of the Tonga arc, and there's a tear in the plate up here that causes it just to go into a strike slip regime. And along this region, we had an outer rise normal faulting great magnitude 8 earthquake. Produced a tsunami that actually took the lives of more American citizens since any event since Sumatra, mainly by the impact on the islands of Samoa, including American Samoa. There was significant 10-meter waves came into some of the coastlines there. It was a great outer rise normal faulting event, and they're intriguing and unusual. And we analyzed this, and we're starting to come to some understanding of the normal faulting, but unable to explain some attributes of the signals. And Chen Ji indicated to us that he thought there was an additional thrust event occurring soon after this normal faulting. We explored that models and we found out that he was indeed correct, that co-seismically with the normal faulting here, this magnitude 8, it induced thrust faulting on the megathrust to the south. So this is reversed of the sequence that occurred in the Kurils, where you had big thrusting pulling on the outer rise, putting it under extension and producing normal faulting. Here we have normal faulting producing thrust faulting. The energy released here, the total seismic moment, is equivalent to a magnitude 8. So this is also a doublet event in that you have an extensional magnitude 8 and a compressional magnitude 8 with this being documented as under thrusting. Now in this case, there was a bit of GPS data. And John Beaven had separately been analyzing observations that were curious, which was that islands after the normal faulting had moved toward the subducting plate, whereas you would expect that normal faulting would have caused this whole package to move westward, but the island moved eastward. And he modeled it separately and independently from us as representing underthrusting with about a magnitude 8 earthquake. So we came to the same conclusion. The only difference was that the GPS was campaign data, so it didn't have really continuous recording. And there was ambiguity about whether the thrusting happened first and then the normal faulting, or in our model, the normal faulting was followed by the thrust faulting. In this case, seismology wins because seismology has good time resolution. But if we can get more continuous high-rate GPS in these regions, it'll contribute to our ability to untangle these types of deformations after big earthquakes. It's very important because of the large tsunami excitation. Figuring out that there was a big thrust that was hidden in the coda of the normal faulting would have helped us to alert for the actual tsunami excitation that occurred. Another surprising event, 2007. One of the axioms that had developed was that subduction zones are segmented. If you subduct a ridge, it disrupts. You don't it breaks up friction. You won't have ruptures go through those regions. So that was kind of a conventional way of thinking. And I had worked very early on with Hira Kanamori in the Solomon Islands on big earthquakes up here. And we saw no earthquakes down along this stretch of the Solomon Islands where there is a subducting ridge. And the argument was, well, the ridge is weak and soft and the friction will be low and you won't build up the stresses to have a magnitude 8 earthquake. I was pretty happy with that general perspective until a magnitude 8 earthquake happened right there. And it showed that while you can have great earthquakes that caused large tsunami and lots of loss of life in the Solomon Islands, in regions that kind of our simple ideas of comparative subductology would have said, well, it's probably a lower risk area for great earthquakes. They would expect them to be happening up where we'd seen them before. Well, so we learned that lesson, but this earthquake was also dramatic in the sense that it ruptured right across the triple junction. So you have a Australian plate down here, you have this chunk of the Solomon Sea plate here, and they're actually going into the subduction zone at different directions because of they have relative motion between them that's got this rifting down there. And the intriguing thing about the solutions is that the data are now good enough that you could actually, in the slip inversions, sense that this patch, which is between the Solomon Sea plate and the Pacific plate, slipped in a different direction by about 30 degrees rake than this patch over here, which is on the Australian plate versus the Pacific plate. So we're getting to the point where we can actually believe the details of these rupture models because they're consistent with the tectonic expectations. But the notion that you could have a rupture across a triple junction with two plates going down at the same time and one event going down in different directions, and we could resolve that, sort of a testimonial to how far we've come with both data collection and inversion capabilities. Large events in Peru, some of these go back to 2001, so a little bit before the big surge of earthquakes, but there was a large event in 2007. Big ruptures along the coast of Peru tested our parameterizations. These both had curious behavior that in slip models that have been published, they had either unexpected, very low rupture velocities had to be invoked, as for this event in 2007, or this event in 2001, there was evidence that rupture kind of zigzagged, it went down, it came back. Curious slip solutions. And in part, we were testing whether those were believable, but with the data sets available and with the inversion capabilities we have, we could explore the parameterization of these ruptures and found that in both cases, the more likely interpretation is that these began with a small rupture, in this case a 7.8 event up here, a 7.4 event down here, that ruptured initially as individual events, and then there's a bit of a hiatus. The Rayleigh waves went from this event down to this region here, triggered a rupture that then spread bilaterally, so it appeared to come back toward the original region, but it wasn't continuous radiation. It was a triggering of a second event that then ruptured back in the direction from which the first event had been located. Here, there was simply a 60-second hiatus, so you have this event, then it shakes over here, and after 60 seconds, you burst out here, and you had a large tsunami-generating event on the other side of this peninsula. It caused a lot of damage and destruction near Pisco. The Chile event came along. We were just trying to keep up with these events, 2008, and the general expectation was that there's a big seismic gap here, the Darwin 1835 gap, the earthquake nucleated, it's located in that region. Everybody's saying, well, it's probably going to fill the slip area that you would expect from 1935, it would be south of the 1928 ruptures. But it surprised us again. It ruptured right through the 1928 rupture, and it didn't even have much slip in the central portion that we think 1835 had ruptured. So this event caught us by surprise. The importance of Chile is perhaps that even relative to the Peru events, there was very little good geodetic control. There were a few stations, and they were important for comparing with the seismic models, but they suggested some differences in interpretation that were ambiguous. But with Chile, we really had great geodetic data. So there's wonderful INSAR profiles across the coast. There was a significant number of campaign and some continuously operating geodetic instrumentation. They had been processed, in this case, by Moreno et al. To see these eastward motions of the coast before the earthquake, had been mapped into ideas, I think this might have been done after the earthquake, but mapped into ideas of the coupling along the fault and demonstrate that we can, with dense geodetic data acquisition, really identify areas that are accumulating strain and interpret slip deficits over large areas along major plate boundaries. So we've got to be doing this everywhere if we can, because it's so valuable to identify where you might have rupture. When the actual event happened, most of the slip, these are early slip models I did with colleagues that suggest that if this is the 1835 region, a lot of the slip was to the north of that. Now, these were seismic-only models, and we can compare subsequent iterations on the seismic models are quite consistent with geodetic. This is from GPS data. This is using INSAR data. These aren't, the differences between the geodetic solutions are as big as the differences relative to seismic, but they're all kind of compatible we can exploit the complementary sensitivities of these different methods and different instrumentation and recording to try and get the best composite models. And that's just underway now. Again, the best prospect is to exploit the full seismogeodetic information in the continuous recordings, as are indicated here in some of Beanie's work with the, these are continuous recordings of the Maldi earthquake from high rate, one sample per second GPS solutions. And they involve both the seismic energy that's arriving here, some surface wave oscillations, and then the static components. What you're seeing here is his forward modeling of those data, but we can actually take these data, put them into inversions and analyze them simultaneously with the seismics, and I'll show some examples of that later. Chile was big enough, as had been the Sumatra earthquake, to actually look for the high frequency radiation sources, and what we find is that the high frequency hugs along the coastline, which is significantly down dip from the offshore large slip. So in this event, if we compare the slip models that I tend to prefer, these fit tsunami and they're pretty compatible with the geodetic data at this point, versus the colors in the background, which are the sources of high frequency radiation, you can see that they don't line up. They're not on top of one another. So you can have as much as 20 meters of slip out here, but very little coherent high frequency energy is being back projected to that region. It seems to be originating down dip of the regions of strong slip. And that's, this is looking at the individual loci. This is averaging over a broad window. So this summarizes some of the different geodetic and seismic and joint inversions that indicate strong slip patches offshore, high frequency radiation. It's patchy and it extends all the way along the coast, but with the biggest peak radiation is certainly down dip and not on top of where the big slip is. So that's an interesting observation that we have been able to make. This summarizes the way I did for the Sumatran earthquake. This is the region where there was significant slip in almost everybody's slip models. This is the regions where almost all the back projection methods indicate high frequency sources. Now the high frequency sources have been elusive. You might expect them to accompany the slip in a direct way. That would be sort of nice, but the reality is that the imaging of the high frequency sources depends on the signal coherence. So it's very sensitive to exactly what the spatial dimension of the rupture front is that's radiating. And I think this corresponds to smaller areas that are rupturing without that much slip or moment, but they give coherent high frequencies that dominate relative to less coherent energy coming from the main slip areas. The last event then that I'll speak about is Tohoku, because it's spectacular all this week. The whole week is filled with amazing observations and models for this earthquake. It's going to be the best studied great earthquake because all the data that we had for earlier events has been even magnified by the tremendous investment that the Japanese had made in geophysical instrumentation, putting huge arrays of GPS and seismic stations, both offshore and onshore, that have accumulated data before and for this earthquake. So this is rupturing off of Honshu. This indicates the huge tsunami. The tsunami coming in as much as 40 meters high along the Sanriku coast, modest along Hokkaido into the south. This little gap here is the area where you can't publish the data because you're too close to Fukushima nuclear power plant. This is the prior history. These dotted lines indicate where big earthquakes had happened. We were pretty comfortable with thinking that the biggest earthquakes that you'll typically expect in this area might be based on the history, where we've had up to magnitude 8.2 or 8.3 events, though historically there have been earlier events that we know much less about. But in the last century, these were the events. And the 1896 tsunami earthquake, the 1933 Great Normal Faulting event, they had established that you could indeed have 30 to 39 meter tsunamis along the Sanriku coast. So it was clear that that could happen, but we didn't have a record of such great tsunamis to the south from the recent events. So everybody was pretty surprised that when the red areas outlined the aftershocks of the 2011 event, when that ruptured this huge area and produced such a huge tsunami, we were all, I think, fairly taken aback by how big it was and how big the overall tsunami was. It was an instance, clearly, where it re-ruptured areas that had failed separately as smaller events. Again, define our expectation, very analogous to 2004 Sumatra, that the ruptures are not strictly segmented and they can amplify their overall impact when you fail areas beyond the kind of identifiable seismic gap type of area on the fault plane. Now, the geodetic instrumentation is wonderful in Japan, and they had for 10 years been accumulating evidence that you have slip deficits along the coast. Most of the interpretations going back over 10 years had tended to put that slip deficit very close to the coast, down dip on the fault. That is largely a resolution issue. It's hard to see further offshore. And the Japanese were doing exactly the right thing. They were going and collecting data offshore, putting instruments all the way out to the trench. If we'd had another 5 years, I think we would have recognized that these coupled zones really existed all the way up, or at least you could map out the zone of strong strain and identify what areas had the potential for large earthquakes. We need to do this for other areas that we anticipate large earthquakes, like Cascadia. We should be doing offshore geodesy to complement the onshore geodesy. Horizontal displacements were spectacular co-seismically. The island of Japan in the center is getting 4.5 meters closer to the U.S. during this event. But you can see the strain across the island that was unleashed by the occurrence of this great thrust. Now, seismic data were quickly analyzed around the world. Within 20 minutes, the USGS had begun to produce reasonable estimates of the total moment magnitude of this event. It's 8.9 and subsequently 9.0. The data were quickly analyzed by many research groups, many of you all analyzing the data freely available from Japanese and U.S. data centers and European data centers. Models like this were developed. This is my own slip inversion indicating up to 60 meters of slip near the trench. This type of models held up pretty well. You could take this model and predict the geodetic statics and do quite well. This indicated that there was nothing in the offsets in the statics that would preclude such large slips that far offshore. There was still some debate over the placement of slip, and the geodesists that were inverting off the GPS observations often pulled the slip down dip. I think in the long term, this is just a suite of recent models. The consistent feature is that most of them are placing slip all the way up to the trench at 50 to 60 meters, even as much as 80 meters has been estimated. Quite remarkable. And again, a demonstration of the collective community capabilities that have evolved for handling these big earthquakes. Here's a characterization of the overall energy release of these, Tohoku in red and 1964 Alaska, the very long duration Sumatra event, the Chile earthquake. And here's just an ordinary little 8.3 earthquake, this little puny guy down here. You wouldn't see Loma Prieta, it would be right down here. So it's kind of humbling working on these big earthquakes, as well as dramatic. Well, using all the distribution of stations across Japan, they recorded the continuous motion. And coming back to this issue of doing seismogeodetic inversion, can you actually take those data and combine them with seismic inversions? And we began to do this in a study with Chuck Amon, where we actually simultaneously inverted the continuous high-rate GPS data. At the time, this is within a week or two of the earthquake, all we had were every 30-second sampling. It took a while to get the higher, or every 15-second sampling. It took a while to get the 1-second sampling out. But that went into this slip inversion. And the slip inversion is actually combines fitting body waves, surface waves. These are surface wave source time functions, so corrected for dispersion. And then these continuous records of geodetic GPS recordings. This is true seismogeodesy, putting together seismic and geodetic, just calling it all ground deformation and inverting it together with a unified formulation. The computation of the Green's functions for the high-rate GPS data in this case was done by summing seismic modes. We simply sum the modes for PREM, you get the complete seismic suite of seismic vibrations plus the static terms from the near field that evolve into the steps of the geodetic statics. Together with Han Yue, a graduate student at Santa Cruz, we've extended this now to inverting the 1 sample per second high-rate GPS from across Honshu. Initially, we just went back to using only the GPS recordings. These are example data, spectacular east-west displacements in the red and complicated vertical displacements. We can invert for slip models. This is the trench on this side. These slip vectors go up to 50 or 60 meters. We get very compatible near trench slip, also significant slip right under the hypocenter. So this is sort of where some of the early geodetic models wanted it. The continuous dynamic inversion with the statics wants some slip all the way out to the trench. We can determine the attributes of the source time functions. Now, most importantly, I guess we fit the data. Now we can fit all of this type of signals, continuous deformation, in the seismogeodetic approach. This shows synthetics and data, and you can't see the details, but you won't see more than one trace on there because they overlap so well. You can really do a good job of fitting the entire complete ground motions that have all the seismic waves, all the near field terms, all the static in a single unified inversion, thereby kind of solving the problem of how do you jointly weight the data from seismology and geodesy, which have been the typical practice of just inverting static vectors along with seismic waves. So this was established as a capability in 2003 in the paper I referenced earlier, but now with great data sets, we can really exercise this. If you really want to restrict yourself, you don't like doing geodesy, you just want seismology, you can take the derivative of those things and record just the dynamic waves and fit those. And then you're still a seismologist. You haven't stepped into geodetic turf. But you get compatible models. And the key thing is that there are different sensitivities to the placement of slip from the distribution of static deformation and the timing of the surface waves and the body waves. They give you very good resolution of the slip compared to any models that I'd seen before from teleseismic inversions for sure, but also from joint inversions that only use various types of seismic data or various types of geodetic data. These are just comparisons of models. This is showing for different parameterized rupture velocity expansions, and it looks like they're boringly similar. Well, that's the point. We could put in 1.5 kilometer per second, 3 kilometer per second rupture, and for the first time, the inversions don't care. They actually have spatial resolution, which is quite dramatic and in my experience, unprecedented. Actually resolve for a great earthquake, where the slip is independent of our kinematic constraints on the rupture process. This will be spoken about further by Hanyue tomorrow in the Tohoku session. A lot of people ask about potency. Why are you using seismic moment? It's just take the moment divided by the rigidity. You're there. You can do that with the Green's functions, and you can find very consistent inversions for potency versus seismic moment. That is not a fundamental gulf between seismologists and geodesists. We have moved forward. Han has begun to simultaneously invert seismic and geodetic information for Tohoku, and it is modifying the models a little bit, so we're getting some additional information. This is an inversion just from high-rate GPS. This is joint high-rate GPS and seismic, teleseismic P waves, and the basic attributes, kind of a two-lobe pattern, do persist, but there are differences, and I think that the combined inversion still makes the most sense. And when we get all the data into these inversions, it will be doing true seismogeodesy as best we can hope to do to characterize these great earthquakes. This just shows, yeah, you can still fit the kind of interesting characteristics of the dynamic and static near-field terms from the high-rate GPS, as well as fitting the details of the teleseismic P waves. More on that to come. That's what people will be doing for the next few decades, is really exercising the maximum extraction of that seismogeodetic information, and that's my prediction. I'll close with just a few words about the high frequencies from Tohoku that lead us to some synthesis of the observation of the different great earthquakes. This is maps showing ground accelerations and ground velocities recorded across Tohoku, and they were spectacular. It was very high frequency shaking, horizontal motions as much as 2.7 G along the coast. So there was a lot of high frequency at 10 hertz, came up and shook the ground. We are interested in where did that high frequency originate on the fault. Here's a comparison of slip models. These were very kind of early days inversions of P data or the joint inversion that Chuck Amon had done, comparing the slip distributions with back projections here done by Keith Koper. And again, you see that the regions where high frequency radiation are imaged are down dip westward of the epicenter here, whereas the main slip is up dip. So it's again an example where you can have 60 meters of slip in shallow parts of the fault zone that is not being manifested as coherent outgoing packages of short period energy that will be imaged by back projection methods. Doesn't mean that there's no short period there, but it's not coherent. It may be coming from a larger, more extended rupture front, or it may simply be that you're not having the particle accelerations in those regions. More detailed work demonstrates that this holds up to periods of around 8 seconds, the highest frequencies coming down near the coast at 1 second, 2 seconds. All the slip, or the biggest slip, is out here. There is slip all the way to the coast, but in this case, it's less than a mere 10 meters, right? It's a small slip. There's still significant slip, but it's not the peak areas of slip at all where the high frequencies are coming from. That leads to this cartoon, which summarizes, again, where the long period resolution of both geodetic and seismic information tells you have large slips versus the kind of loci of high frequency bursts of energy that are imaged by back projection algorithms. And it's down dip. This summarizes then for Sumatra, for Chile, and for Tohoku, this systematic pattern that the blue areas, the high frequency radiators, tend to be down dip in each case of the regions of very large slip in yellow. So I spoke a bit about this yesterday as a notional model for kind of segmentation of the megathrust, where we can identify kind of, well, pull together all the collective observations of tsunami earthquakes and these recent really great earthquakes that rupture great width across the megathrust, but with differing frequency of radiation, to identify that there are different domains, which I label creatively A, B, and C, along the megathrust, the shallowest being the domain of the tsunami earthquakes, known to have very large displacement with very little high frequency radiation. This is, you know, something that Hiro pointed out in 1971. The main portion of the megathrust from about 15 down to 30 kilometers where there's large slip events, that can happen with modest amounts of high frequency radiation in these great earthquakes, versus the down dip region from about 30 to 50 kilometers where you have less total slip in these large earthquakes, but you have these high frequency bursts of radiation that come out and be coherently imaged. So this notion that there are distinct domains seems to hold for these great earthquakes that span across all the domains. We're trying to interpret that. I think at some level it's very early stages because it's complicated to understand the relationship of high frequency radiation to the long period slip, because many processes in the rupture front expansion can produce high frequency bursts that won't be manifested in significant slip heterogeneity that we'll image from long periods. So it brings us back to notional models similar to what we invoked back in 1981 of asperity type model distributions, shallow portions of the fault with kind of patchy areas which can fail in tsunami earthquakes with very low kind of coherent short period radiation, deeper patches that can fail with large slip, and then perhaps the deepest edge, really not illustrated in this figure, that has small patches again that you get high frequency bursts out of. Well, let me summarize this kind of this retrospective on this last decade of great earthquakes and how it's transformed what we know about earthquakes. I've just barely scratched the surface of all the details, and many of the studies that you all have conducted are contributing to this, and I certainly appreciate being able to give my take on this, but it's a tremendous advance over this last decade. It's easy to forget where we were just 10 years ago when we hadn't had a really big earthquake for a long time and hadn't exercised all the capabilities that had emerged. The situation today, and hopefully we can sustain both these networks of seismic and geodetic instrument, upgrade them, make more of them continuous, make more of them real-time telemetry, make much more extensive spatial coverage of all the critical zones, including those that don't have big earthquakes, because we need to know, are they accumulating strain to have that surprising magnitude 9 in Tonga or in Marianas? We need to answer those questions, so we're going to have to pursue what we've demonstrated to be successful, collect the data, anticipate that we'll learn from it, whether there's coupling or not, and then utilize these capabilities that have emerged to analyze the events that happen, as well as the interseismic and postseismic intervals. So this kind of systematic effort has really paid off, and it's a tribute not to me, but to the many people that developed techniques and methods over the decades when there wasn't any really big earthquake to play with, that now we see the bounty of results coming from that investment, and it's a real testimonial to how valuable that has been. Ultimately, the comprehensive modeling of all the dynamic and static motions together makes sense. We don't need to be seismologists or geodesists. We're just working with ground motions. We want to characterize as much of that behavior as possible to get the best handle on what happens pre-seismically, co-seismically, and post-seismically. So that's why seismogeodesy is a really great thing. If we're going to have more and more unions between seismologists and tectonophysicists and geodesists, this is all to the good. Now, I have not given equal time because of the time limits here to testify to how great the progress has been in tsunami analysis. If you've gone to the tsunami sessions, it's extremely similar. There have been tremendous advances in our understanding of the propagation attributes, the characterization of slip from tsunamis, and the collection of data. So together with tsunamis and geodesy and seismology, we are really now able to understand megathrust ruptures better than we ever had. I think we're at the state where we can begin to synthesize very preliminary and simplistic models. They're not too dramatic at this point, but there are at least good modes of discussing the properties and domains in which we see different type of behavior on megathrust. So thanks for coming, and let's all celebrate big earthquakes because it's good for business.
So we have a lot of time for questions and discussion. However, this is a large room and this is being filmed, so I would ask that you use the microphone there. That would be a starting point. If not, you'd be really loud and Thorne will repeat the question. So let's start out. It's hard to see up here. We've got somebody.
Hello.
It's not on.
Is there a switch on that? Yeah, it's on.
It's on. Just speak right into it.
You talked a lot about the megathrusts between oceanic plates and subduction zones, but what about the megathrust in the Himalayas? Do you think it's also going to have these magnitude 9 type of earthquakes?
I fear it's potentially could. I've emphasized where they've happened, but there have been significant events in Pakistan and whatnot that I didn't address. But along that frontal range, you would think that there is potential for very large earthquakes, and we need to be similarly densely instrumenting it, trying to measure strain accumulation.
Thank you.
Yeah, I myself has experienced the largest earthquake in North America in Alaska. And you talk about how every earthquake has its own personality, it's very true. I mean, I've probably experienced like 35 earthquakes in my lifetime. And what you say about how, when you first started off with your presentation, how earthquakes have its own personality, it's very true. It's what you have said is basic fact. And it's very interesting that you've said that.
Yeah, well, thank you. I think it's been interesting how every event has surprised us.
Like a lot of the stuff you throw out with the bathwater, I mean, all of a sudden, this stuff comes out of nowhere, and it's like, you know, it's just like crazy, you know? I mean, we've only been on the planet for doing this stuff for 100 years, or less than 100, and the planet's been around for a billion.
Fair enough.
Well, my question is from the geodesy standpoint. We record much sparser data than seismology, but what would be optimal? What rate should we record the GPS data at so that we could combine well with seismology? We have the capability of recording 20 hertz data, but generally we record 1 hertz because that's been the standard in the surveying community.
Well, that's an interesting question. I mean, certainly in Japan, with 1,200 high-rate GPS solutions available, it's almost as dense as the seismic coverage. I do suspect that if we have this perspective of really addressing the value added of the dynamic component that you want to sample and get the move out of seismic waves, if you're going to interpret the details, that we could develop rules of thumb for what the optimal spacing is in order to resolve attributes of the slip. With Japan, because the data are so spectacularly densely sampled, we have unprecedented resolution. So I'd kind of like to see Japan all around the circumpacific in terms of coverage, but that's probably not realistic. So I think some assessment, maybe jointly between the seismology and geodetic communities, of what is the optimal sampling to try and best recover the things we want to learn in terms of pre-seismic, post-seismic, and post-seismic, that would be really worth doing because there are limited resources. But more is better. I think everybody likes having this density of data.
Yeah, Thorne, you didn't mention the possible complementary utility of borehole and other strain networks in addition to the GPS data. Is there still a lot to be mined in that type of data?
I'm really not competent to speak about borehole strain because I've never seen a borehole strain record I understood. I think that it's possible that if we do attain an understanding of local effects and can sort out and calibrate them, they should be valuable. We have a lot of data to work with in Cascadia, but I understand it is challenging to turn it into information that we can that would be anywhere comparable to what we can get out of more high-rate GPS combined with OBSs and offshore geodetic. My personal emphasis, offshore geodetic would have paid off a huge bounty for Tohoku. I think it will elsewhere if we can do that.
Quickly, why do we have a large displacement of the shallow portion? Is it because elastic strains accumulated at the shallow portion or elastic strains accumulated at the deeper portion and it propagates?
It's a great question. I think with Tohoku, it's probable that the strong strain accumulation is sort of in the center of the megathrust and that the updip region was kind of congested and went as block motion. I can't imagine that the strain was, to accommodate such large displacements was really continuous throughout the toe. But to answer that question, we need the data all the way out to the toe to see what is the distribution of strain accumulation. I think if we had, profiles across some of the major threatening subduction zones, we could assess where the distribution of strain is, identify the knots that may be holding back, and assess what type of earthquake and tsunami excitation could occur. But my feeling is that it's the center of the fault that held up most of that region.
David Lumley, University of Western Australia. I was very interested in your observation in the shift between the high-frequency sources and the large slip mechanisms. And coming from a seismic imaging perspective, there's a trade-off between the location of the sources and velocity heterogeneity. Do you think that shift, is it possible it might actually be those high-frequency sources are actually trying to tell us something about velocity heterogeneity?
Well, it's a little bit difficult to answer. One test of stability of the imaging was to look at small events and see, do we find the centroid of slip and the centroid of high-frequency radiation close together? When we do that, we find that indeed we image it in the same place for small events along all the arcs that I showed. That says that it's not a velocity refraction or something that's causing a misplacement of the image. So in that sense, it may not be particularly sensitive to the velocity heterogeneity because we it goes where you would expect with a small event. It's only in these very big events that you get this sort of depth-dependent variation. That's why I think it's probably correct, is it's not that sensitive to the velocity structure. That being said, we use very simple models for back projection, so everything's got an uncertainty of tens of kilometers in the location of the regions of high energy release.
You've developed some very good ideas on what makes earthquakes stop, and then the recent data suggests that at least segmentation is not the clue to understanding the upper limit to earthquake magnitude. And earthquake rupture can now go around triple junctions. Do you now have a feeling for what does limit the size of earthquakes? And would magnitude 10 someplace, sometime, surprise you?
Yes, it would. I do think that, to get above, magnitude 9.5, requires such a favorable conditions of stress heterogeneity and non-disruption of the kind of continuity of the arc that it would be surprising to really do that in many places. To get to 10, you're going to rupture the entire length of South America and Central America and hopscotch through California and get into the Aleutians. I would be surprised. Hollywood might not, but... But I think the point is that the conventional ideas that we were using to define upper size of earthquake are all questionable. And particularly Sumatra demonstrated to me that, wow, that It can go, and there was a lot of tsunami excitation, significant deformation all along that 1,000-kilometer extension that I wouldn't have anticipated. If say, central Kermadec, which is one of the areas that's coupled, goes, could rupture go 1,000 kilometers along Tonga? I would be hesitant to say that can be ruled out. The way we could test is to go in and look at strain accumulation. I think what can stop ruptures is if there is no strain there to tap. I think that the region offshore of Sanriku, we have no indication of it being seismically coupled. I believe it served as a strain energy sink, and it stopped the rupture going to the north. It stopped the rupture in 1896 from going down dip. So I'd say if we can identify where those no-slip deficit regions are, they may be the best delimiters of future great earthquakes, though we still could get surprised if they can hopscotch through there. That's a great question.
I think the distinction between geodesy and seismometry is somewhat artificial. Is that happening that geodesy is replacing seismometry? Because you mentioned the sampling rate of one sample per second. If you simply increase this to, say, 50 samples per second, you don't need seismometers anymore because your GPS receivers are collecting.
Right, you're making Bino turn over in his grave right now. But no, I think there will be limits to how good the solutions for the high sample rate GPS will ever be. That as you go above several hertz, in particular, a very inexpensive accelerometer will get that signal correctly. It won't do as well out at 500 seconds. So I think they are now and will continue to be complementary, but we have to exploit the added attribute from the GPS for dealing with the very slow deformations of the inner seismic time frame. So for seismic, I think still you have to study a seismology textbook that Terry and I wrote. That's got some value.
Cheap plug. One comment on an earlier question first, and then a question related to that comment. The question before about whether there was a bias in the location of the high-frequency energy relative to the large slip. I think Jim Morey gave a talk, was it at SSA, anybody remember, where he resolved that by, I think, looking at the relative timing of the geodetic and seismic recordings, showing that the high-frequency energy did come from a closer position relative to the low-frequency, stronger geodetic signal. So I think that question was clearly resolved, that those two are spatially separate. My question is related to the high-frequency part, which is, what's your vision for what that part of the fault looks like? And are we looking at places where, in between these patches that are failing in high-frequency, they're like little magnitude 5-6 earthquakes, and there's creep in between? Or have you a different vision for what that part of the fault looks like?
Well, a lot of the areas that had the high-frequency radiation are regions close to areas that had prior offshore the Miyagi-Oki-type events. So they can sustain magnitude 7. So I think there's a distribution of characteristic scale lengths there, and that maybe the high-frequency imaging that's tuned to a half hertz or 1 second is sampling particular scale length of heterogeneity over which you have a rupture acceleration that give you a coherent burst of energy. So I see it as being sort of a statistical distribution of asperities there that grades perhaps as you go deeper into regions where you might have tremor and episodic slip, as you kind of have further subdivision of the patches that are seismogenic with larger and larger percentage being, stably sliding. So, but it's still very much in the cartoon form, and so I still make cartoons after 30 years. I think at this point we're still nailing down the observation. Some people don't necessarily agree with Maury's interpretation of the high frequencies originated deep, and in fact you can take the strong ground motion records and low pass filter them, and the long period certainly fit where the tall seismics have slipped. But establishing or having good enough Green's functions to really predict the pathways by which the high frequency travel is still a big challenge. So doing it teleseismically is like using a very blunt instrument. You know, it's like almost dumb way to do it when you're looking. You can't see the 10 hertz energy you'd really like to see. We need to analyze better the propagation of that 10 hertz energy to say exactly where it originated.
I was just wondering, you had a very incredibly good fit between your seismic and your geodetic information. What about some of the other types of information, such as the tsunami modeling and also the repeat seismics that they've done along the trench? How well can you match your data to these completely different kinds of data sets?
Yeah, the tsunami observations, particularly the DART observation, are extraordinarily well fit by multiple models, including the models I had. The collaborators that I've worked with have been able to model the tsunami DART signals extraordinarily well. The hardest part of the tsunami modeling remains getting run-up calculations consistently because of the nonlinear nature and even questions about excitation of the tsunami. So there's still, things that don't agree perfectly, but I'd say that the level of fit is as good for the seismic waves as it is for the DART data, where you have fairly simple propagation characteristic. And there was a second part besides tsunami?
Well, yeah, just the repeat seismics that they've done across the trench.
Well, of course, the repeat seismics have been very valuable for identifying static motions and offsets, and they, I put together that model with 60 meters slip before I heard that they had measured 60 meters of slip offshore with the repeat measurements. It gave us some confidence, and that's held up pretty well as many investigations now find that. It's great to have that type of ground truth because neither the seismic or the geodetic models were that confident in exact placement of the slip. Whenever you have some independent observation, and they also got further observations from offsets of OBS, instruments when they reoccupied them, that's just wonderful to have, and I view that as part of the geodetic information that gets folded into these comprehensive earthquake models.
In your first slide, you showed the map of the large earthquakes in the past decade or so, and of course it was very notable that North America doesn't show anything, and I would just be curious to hear your thoughts on that.
Well, I'm a strong advocate of the GeoPrism's focus on Cascadia. I think we should be, even if we think the Cascadia event isn't necessarily imminent, we should be getting baseline information, doing offshore geodesy, looking at strain accumulation there. It's the best prospect for a magnitude 9 in the conterminous U.S. We have the opportunity to make the measurements now. I think that the technologies have been established. The Japanese have set a great precedent for what you can learn if you do it. We need to do it. So that would be a major concern for me, for at least for the U.S., is Cascadia. But I think many people agree, and the effort is there. We're putting the ARRA funds into it. IRIS has re-instrumented the area to put more of the U.S. Array assets there. It's really I think the community agrees. That's the area that we have the greatest potential for that size event. And I think, we don't want to end up being in the situation that Sumatra was, where we're nailed by a tsunami that just overwhelms us. So there's a lot of lessons to be learned from Japan in terms of mitigation and societal preparation for that event. May not happen for some time, but I'd say now we can go learn what we can now and measure, instrument the area as well as possible.
Brief historical note, I think in light of the magnificent, spectacular results that you showed by combining seismology and geodesy, Ted Flynn at NASA was arguing for this 35 years ago or more, and I think articulated very well the idea that seismology and geodesy were measures of deformation that tell us a lot about earthquakes, plate tectonics, and sort of how the whole scientific results fit together. And I think his pushing for development of space geodesy within NASA really was a contributing factor to the great techniques that we have available for us now, even though he didn't live to see some of the recent developments.
No, I'd echo that, absolutely. I had the opportunity to get to know Ted a bit and saw him as a visionary, and I do wish that he'd lived to see some of the accomplishments from this geodetic investment.
Okay, my question is about the very shallow part of the subduction zone. Given Tohoku and Mentawai event and maybe the Tonga event, is there really any reason to believe that everywhere along all subduction zones, the very shallowest part is not capable of having very large slip? Is there any evidence that we would have that would say that some parts are not capable? Or are we just assuming that they're not because we always used to think of it as being a weakly coupled region?
Well, I'm afraid the situation is sort of the latter. I mean, the number of demonstrable exceptions, the number of tsunami earthquakes that have been observed is still on the order of 7, that we have really well-documented large slip out at the toe, up dip of regions that have had big thrusts or not. That's a small enough percentage of all the circumpacific that you say, well, are they the exception or is it somebody the long repeat times and large strain accumulations that are precluding us from having a more comprehensive sampling? I suspect that the only way we're going to answer that is to go and measure strain deformation in a lot of places because I am worried that, you know, even if you look up dip off of Chile, none of the models are finding rupture going all the way to the trench. Is it too weak? Did it all relax? Has it gone as post-seismic and we just can't see it? Those questions persist, and they're sort of unacceptable because these events can produce 10-meter, even 30-meter tsunamis coming in as in 1896. So, Hiro kind of alerted us this class of earthquakes long ago, and we've just sort of never gotten too worried about it. But I think that in terms of realistic seismic hazard assessment, the possibility of these types of events has to be considered. It was considered explicitly along Japan in their seismic hazard models because they had the 1896 event as a demonstration. I don't think it's been figured into a lot of other local regions. Thank you.
Okay, well, let's thank Thorne again for a very important, stimulating talk.